pretty impatient, aren't you, Charlie? Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to ask you to join me in rewarding a group of musicians who are the finest in the land today. These boys make all of the recordings that you hear, or most of the ones that you hear, with all of the great singers. And they are the highest caliber musician in the United States today. And they all came along with me from Los Angeles. And I want to tell you, it's been a mothery ball from the beginning to the end. These are the group of musicians from Los Angeles. Now, Jacques. This is a money. There's money down here. Who's been playing here? Tommy Mansfield or somebody? This is a little song that came from a motion picture that I loved making at MGM. Turned out to be pretty great, and it was a kind of a fun picture. The song was unusual. You see a pair of laughing eyes. Suddenly you're sighing sighs. You're thinking nothing's wrong. You string along, boy, then snap. Those eyes, those sighs, they're part of the tender trap.
Ah, oh, man. Just beautiful. He was a great guy. He could draw stuff out of you just like Stan Kenton could, like I explained earlier in the interview. Frank was the most resilient singer ever heard. He could sound like crap at the afternoon rehearsal and sound check, and come back for the show and just nail it, dead center, no mistakes, everything perfect. And if he did something different, he worked it in so it was not a mistake. It was just him, like a jazz musician, you know. The gang are throwing shoes. So off and on for 17 years in L.A. He had three bands. He had the Las Vegas band, the New York band, and the West Coast band. I was in the West Coast band. And during those 17 years, I played every trombone chair on that, you know, first, second, third, bass trombone, I played them all. And the trombone book is a lot of fun. There's a lot of stuff to play in there. I mean, a lot of good charts by the best arrangers in the world. Don Costa, you know, all the good guys. Frank had the best charts of anybody. And it was a pleasure to go and play every night. Every night that he had a gig, it was great, man. We'd go and hang afterwards. Different places. Frank used to like to go to Scoma's on the Wharf. He knew Frank Scoma. And so we went there, the guys in the band went there, because Frank had said, go to Scoma's, guys. And he sprung for one dinner when we just jumped on the train and went over. And we were playing at Sammy Davis's theater in the round up there. So this particular time I'm talking about. So we went to Scoma's and we got royal treatment, you know, royal treatment. And I became really good friends with the cook, Jimmy, who they had abalone, but not for everybody, just for special people. And he knew how much I loved abalone, and he would always save me some abalone. If he knew that Frank was in town, I had abalone at Fisherman's Wharf. And stayed that way. I even took Yoli there after, when we were just up there on our own. I used to tell jokes when I was a joke teller. I used to tell jokes to Jilly Rizzo, who was Frank's right-hand guy, boyhood friend. And He used to run Frank down the aisle and to the stage, you know, make a big thing of Jilly, you know. Jilly, unfortunately, died in a very horrible accident. He was going to his, they were throwing a birthday party for him at Frank's house. Jilly was on his way in Palm Springs in a Jaguar. He drove, had a brand new Jaguar. And somebody ran a red light and broadsided him on the driver's side, smashed it in. They couldn't get the door open. The car, all everything was locked. And the car caught fire. And they could see him inside. People could see him. Couldn't get the windows. They couldn't break the windows, anything. And he was screaming and hollering. And it was a horrible death, horrible death. So that really affected Frank a lot. Frank wasn't the same for a long time. They were emotionally connected, you know, from boyhood, for sure. And then Jilly was kind of like Frank's enforcer the whole time, you know, the bodyguard. The summer wind. I got a book, Mr. S and Me. I'm looking at it right now. I'm going to let you read it right tonight or something when you hear, you can thumb through it. Written by the guy that wrote it, it's a friend of ours. And he was Frank's valet for 17 years, personal valet. Lived in the house, did all this. All summer long, we sang a song, and then we strolled. It'll give you some insight into Frank. Not everybody has, you know, he had other sides to him, too. He had cruel sides to him. He had practical joke sides to him that weren't funny, you know. There's a lot of stuff about Frank that didn't have anything to do with his singing. But his singing is a part of his life that I was connected with. And that, to me, was the best part. And the fun they had with the Rat Pack. We were doing a date for Frank. Summer Wind. That album, Summer Wind. And Frank says, I got a treat, boys. And here comes Sammy Davis in a little waiter outfit pushing a booze cart. Dean Martin behind him walking in. So we all had a drink. And we recorded that album and probably two takes, everything, no more than two takes. It was Frank didn't like to mess around. You rehearse it, you got it, you're a high-paid professional, you play it like you mean it, and then it'll come out great. And he was the same way with his vocals, man. He'd get, sing it through, that's it, okay, next. And sure enough, it turns out it was great. He was a master, I must say. And it was a lot of fun. We had the best accommodations where we stayed. We always stayed at, we had separate suites, each and every one of us at the Four Seasons. Yeah, own room, own suite. We stayed in the Four Seasons in Vancouver, and every room is different, every suite is different. Different ceiling angles and everything, and wood, high ceilings, and oh man, really, really over the top fancy. Depending on which chair was playing, depending on the horn I would take. Usually just had one horn.
Were you doing the Williams at that time?
No, Bach. Bach 16M. What you playing?
Yeah, it's my favorite.
That's what I got.
What was the process of getting on the West Coast band?
I got a call from the contractor. Said, you want to work with Frank? I said, what do you think? Yeah,
really?
That was it. Contractor was, at first was Bill Miller, who was a keyboard player. Almost as famous as Frank, the gray-haired guy, used to stand up and conduct, big glasses. That was Bill Miller. Great guy. We used to hang out a lot at Alfonso's. Yeah.
remember your first rehearsal with the guys? Or?
With Frank?
Yeah.
The first rehearsal? I don't remember that. I remember I was just amazed that I was finally getting a chance to play in his band with all of these. He had seven different books for every key, you know, F down to B. Because wherever his voice was, and as years went on, his voice got lower. And it was harder and harder to get those, well, do it my, you know. So, you had to be prepared to play My Way in F, or maybe C sharp. D flat, that's not bad. D flat is the same, enharmonically, the same as C sharp. B, you just never knew. I don't think we ever had to do it in B. But he had a book for B, and that's what we always look for. The first thing I did when I would sit down at the rehearsal, get my book, I'd open it up, see which book it was. If it was the F book, E book, yeah. Okay. All right, yeah, okay. Here we go. And it was a ball because he had all great players. Bob Cooper, tenor player. Lanny Morgan. Jack Nimitz.
Bob Cooper came to your home, right?
Mm, yeah, Bob Cooper came to my home. Sure he did.
I think I met him.
You could, a big tall guy.
Yeah, we went out in the rowboat together.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Good.
You and him and I. How was doing the duets album?
Oh, it was good. I got a couple of solos on that album, and Bono sang over both of them. You kind of hear him, but it's just a copy of Milt Bernhardt's solo, my version of his solo, you know, because it's a classic solo. And I knew Bono or somebody was going to sing over it anyway, so. But that was, it was just like another record date. Came in and there was an unusual premise for the date, you know, the duets thing. And some of the other vocalists were piped in, you know, from Florida, Gloria Estefan from Florida. Somebody from New York, I think Chicago. And then other ones would come and appear. But they made a link hook up with other studios so that they could do the thing back and forth while wearing it. You know, it was amazing.
But I remember when that duets album came out, it really created that genre for duets.
With, yeah.
You know, star singing with other stars and all the same recordings. And
yeah.
How many,
it started a trend, kind
it did.
Of. Yeah.
It really did. Did that album go over a few recording dates, obviously, because with a different people?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was several dates. And I didn't do all the dates. I couldn't do one. I did all but one. And Charlie Loper gets his name on the credits because he did the one where the contractor wrote the contract out and then he put Charlie Loper down. But Charlie only did one session. Charlie still says, geez, I'm sorry about that. I said, not your fault. It was Jules' fault. And I got on Jules' phone and he says, oh, shit, I'm sorry. I didn't even think, you know. So that's how that was. But I'm on there anyway. Yoli says that she can hear my sound now that I've made records and things like that. She can tell when it's me and rather than somebody else.
Yeah,
which is neat.
That's very true.
That's what when a good musician, as you matured, you get to know somebody's sound. You know, like you're listening to records, and you know, you get to hear the difference between Stan Getz and Zoot Sims. The difference in their playing, it's very recognizable. So you hear somebody say, oh, that's Stan Getz. and something. Oh, that's so simple. So it's just a musical recognition and how you comprehend to the point of knowing who they are. I love you when you're under my skin.
Do you remember the last time that you recorded with Sinatra's band?
Before I left. No, I really don't. I remember we played his 75th birthday party at the one of these theaters or someplace we were with, and I was right in the middle, right behind him. Frank was out in the audience with Barbara, his wife. And Harry Connick came out to sing a song. And your cheeks so soft, there is nothing for me but to. And fucked up the start of it and had to start, and blew the start of the song and had to start over. And that's something that Frank never did put up with.
Oh.
From anybody, you know, starting over and stopping and this and that, you know, you gotta get it done at the professional. And that life. He didn't talk about Harry Connick or didn't speak to him for a long time, Frank didn't. I think they finally patched up their wounds. Lovely. Never. Change. Keep that breathless charm. Won't you please arrange it? 'Cause I love you just the way you look tonight. Touches my foolish heart. Lovely, don't you ever change. Keep that breathless charm. Won't you please arrange it? 'Cause I love you just the way you look tonight. Just the way you look tonight.